everybody. Thank you, Rajesh, for your very kind words of introduction. And is it projected up there? Yeah. As well as people who actually did the inviting and so on, Professor Kundu and Professor Basu, I thank you all for giving me this chance to visit this place and give a talk. And I also want to thank, although I don't think any of them is here in the room, the very efficient administrative people who made the logistics of this visit so simple and pleasant. So it's very nice to be here. So what I'm going to do is really give a story from the beginning to end. So to experts, there is nothing here that's new. And I'm giving a sly look at, where is he? Where? No, Subratana, our old friend. So, of disarmament, the whole phenomenon of disarmament, how it all started, what are all the things that it went through, and where it stands today. And the zero and the nuclear zero stands for the concept of a world with zero nuclear weapons, which a phrase that was invented around the time of Obama's presidency. And the road to that has had its ups and downs, so that's the title. So the early days began already as, almost as soon as the bomb was dropped. The call for nuclear disarmament, that we should get rid of it, is as old as the nuclear era itself. And in fact, interestingly, some of the people who were at the front line of the call for disarmament were also the people who were involved in building the bomb. So the process of trying to get rid of it is as old as the beast itself. So voices could be heard seeking a ban on these weapons from way back. And some of these individual voices coalesced into anti-nuclear movements. And prominent amongst them at that time were the protests in UK led by Bertrand Russell, which really got a fair deal of support. And then the Pugwash movement was born. Einstein was behind that. He supported it. The Bulletin of Atomic Scientists was born. There was a doomsday clock in it, which tells you how close you are to nuclear disaster. And government-wise also, in under Pandit Nehru's leadership, India was one of the first nations to advocate officially and in the UN disarmament. And this was as early as 1948. So there was some amount of movement towards getting rid of them. But these anti-nuclear voices and movements were not strong enough to overcome the dynamics of post-World War II geopolitics. The World War II alliance between the US, USSR, and UK, but in particular the USSR and US, were already pretty wary. They were, you know, it was a very kind of friendship, each one watching out for the other. It completely came apart after the war. They began to view one another as their principal enemies. Germany was, of course, defeated. And it, this sense of rivalry and enmity was reinforced by ideological differences between the quote-unquote communist and the quote-unquote democratic way of, capitalist way of government. And each side was keen in geopolitics to prevent the other from propagating its philosophy and its control of large swaths of the globe. So in that atmosphere, once the Soviets had also developed their first nuclear weapon, which it had to happen, they were not that far behind. Besides, they had some people planted in the US anyway. So within a couple of years, the Russians had their bomb. Then the H-bomb was developed by the Americans, but so did the Russians. So pretty soon, a full-fledged thermonuclear arms race between the US and USSR was off and running already by the mid-60s. And by 1960, each side had tens of thousands of weapons, okay, enough to destroy not just a couple of cities like Hiroshima and Nagasaki, but essentially all of human civilization through a variety of effects. And here's a graph that tries to say that. You can see the growth in the number. This is number of weapons. This is years going from 1950 to 1985. And you can see the steady climb. This little hump here was because there was a brief period when neither the US nor USSR was building any more weapons. But then USSR started building some more, then it went up. So this was the situation in the mid-80s, 60,000 weapons, And most of them more powerful, all of them, except a few, more powerful than what went on Hiroshima or Nagasaki. So you can imagine the amount of destructive potential that had accumulated in the world by then. So this seems like utter madness. I mean, why do you want to create a weaponry that will not just destroy one or two places, but the whole world, many times over? What were these people thinking of? It's very hard to figure out. Till today, I haven't been able to quite understand. I talked to many friends who, some of them have survived that period, and when I talked to them, what exactly were they? But generally, one knows, I was also there some of that period, their stated goal was to win the nuclear war. They were going to win the war. And this is very strange, because these are nations, in particular the US, I have direct experience, went out with some of the best minds, best intellects, philosophers, wise statements, thoughtful writers. But those countries surprisingly made a very naive extension of the notion of winning from conventional warfare to nuclear warfare. They thought it would just be more of the same. And as the nuclear weapons grew into the tens of thousands, there were absurd claims made by allegedly very sensible, pragmatic people from both sides. Each one thought they had a winning arsenal. What do they mean by winning arsenal? They could kill 60% of the other country, and the others could only kill 40% of yours. Now, there was who's right, who's wrong, it doesn't matter. Regardless of all that, with 100 million people killed on each side, whether life in either country would ever be the same, and whether such a victory would at most be Pyrrhic in the extreme, didn't seem to discourage them from continuing this view. Somehow, it's amazing, it's hard for me to believe that people didn't pause and say, look, what will it be like if we had even 30% of our people killed, or even 20%. So there was a certain momentum in the air. There was McCarthy in the US. Various factors contributed to all this. And that is how these numbers piled up. So it was a mad thing. But then it became officially a mad thing. By that, I'll explain this. Gradually, the US government, those are the days when the US was learning the trick of spinning something. So it spun this crazy thing. By giving it the name, they said that there's some insanity to this. Instead of winning a nuclear war, they said the purpose of these weapons is as a strategy of deterrence. While still retaining the same huge number of weapons, the deterrence relied on mutually assured destruction, whose acronym was, in fact, MAD, appropriately. And the idea, of course, was that since each side's arsenal could destroy the other country many times over, it's not that we are planning to win the war, but you see, because we've got this kind of arsenal, it will succeed in frightening the other country from considering a nuclear attack on another. This notion of deterrence is present till today. Almost every country says that is the reason for their having nuclear weapons. Of course, each country has to be convinced of the other's readiness to retaliate with such assured destruction in order to be deterred. So, therefore, each country had to make sure that it had enough bomb power to guarantee destruction to the other side, even in the face of an incoming attack. So this added further levels of craziness to it. Maintaining such readiness involved an extremely complex and nerve-wracking exercise. Given that the intercontinental ballistic missile, IBM's travel time to go from anywhere in USSR to the US or vice versa, it was only about 37, 38 minutes, depending on where it was launched. So during the Cold War, each side was convinced that the other side did have the capability, that within these 40 minutes, they'll be able to retaliate. So as a result, in fact, MAD did provide deterrence. Neither side dared to do anything which would invite that kind of reply. And in fact, it remains till today, right now, till today, as the basic core of the nuclear strategy between Russia and the US. And perhaps between the US and one or two other countries too. But that in itself is okay. But even though neither side would deliberately attack the other for fear of assured destruction, the possibility of an attack by accident and by miscalculation or misjudgment was very much there. And it's important to dwell on this a little bit, because that possibility, I want to explore what type it was. And that adds to one's concern about nuclear weapons. This was because of the very precarious way nuclear weapons were and still are deployed in the US and now Russia, and given the very short transit time of ICBMs between the two places. So as I said, the typical ICBM carrying nuclear warheads will go from its Russian launch pads to its targets in the US or vice versa in 35 to 40 minutes. And if it's launched by submarine, it would be even less. So this contributes an additional level of menace to the nuclear armament process, above and beyond the dangers of a deliberate attack of one side or the other. So we will, I want to dwell on this a little, we'll briefly digress from the history of disarmament to explain how dangerous and how precarious this was. There are some lessons even we could learn from it. Since that also provided an active added motivation for nuclear disarmament, the level of danger posed even if you don't deliberately attack the other country. So that comes from this phenomenon, this posture of launch on warning. So since MAD requires that as soon as either the US or conversely the USSR detects and reliably identifies enemy missiles heading towards it, it would have to immediately set in motion a retaliatory strike on the enemy within those 30 minutes of time before it hits your head. And once it comes there and hits your weapons with its own, there's no possibility of retaliation. So you had only 30, 40 minutes to retaliate after you detect that something has come from there. So either you retaliate before you detect anything coming, which means you're again starting a war for no reason. So nobody wanted that. So you really wanted to start the process as soon as you detect something and then complete the process in those 40 minutes. That was the level of precariousness. Of course, when there is tension in the air, the possibility of attacks, you become prepared, but you don't launch anything just because there's tension in the air. And even if Khrushchev, you know, slams a shoe on the table and so on, you don't, that's all fine. Or somebody says, we don't have no first year, we do. All that is talk. But once you detect something coming, that's when you know you have no choice but to retaliate if that's your policy. So otherwise, your retaliatory capabilities have no use. Therefore, to make this happen, the US had to do following things. First, it had to maintain an elaborate system of satellites and radars to detect an incoming attack. The first process in that is the detection of the launch itself by infrared devices sitting in your satellites, which says that something is in it. This is a very tricky thing because sometimes you fire a steel mill that produces as much heat as the firing of a satellite, I mean of a rocket. So you have to be very careful about what the signal is that your satellites are giving you. But they had refined this quite a bit. So this is something you had to do, was to have early warning satellites. Then its own weaponry must be in a state of full alert. There are various levels of alert at which you can keep your weapons. This, they have to have them in full alert, ready to go, so-called launch on warning, to be unleashed on the adversary in the face of an impending attack. And then you had to set up a command and control system to process this whole business of very rapid detection and response. Furthermore, such is the logic of nuclear deterrence that the ability of the US to launch on warning its counterattack should be known to the USSR. Otherwise, deterrence won't work. They should know. If we hit them, they will hit us. And they have the power to do so. Should be known to the USSR and considered credible by them, and vice versa. So this was necessary. And that meant that in spite of all the secrecy, these sides, a lot of hush-hush, people went to jail and all that, spies and all that stuff. In spite of all that, each side had to tacitly let the other side know enough about its capabilities to know that they know you can do it. And so you have to, as I said, let them peek into the zanana from time to time. Even if a Soviet missile were detected from the very moment of its launch, given the system, some time will be used, first of all, in confirming that it is, in fact, a missile system coming at you, with sufficient confidence to send up the message up the chain of command. It'll go all the way to the president. Within those 30 minutes, all this has to happen. And the president, in turn, has to, aided by his civilian secretary of defense, secretary of state, and so on, and generals, military advisors, has to make as rational a decision as you can under those circumstances on whether or not to unleash a massive counterattack. Everything is ready for it because all the missiles are in the silos, the planes were circulating those days anyway. Some number of nuclear-carrying bombers were always in the air at that time. So all this calls for an extremely fast, reliable, disciplined chain of decision-making at every stage. And some information on how on earth you do this and how much time was spent on what is now available in the public realm. There are good books written on it. I've prepared a chart just for to showing it here. We don't have to sit on the chart for too long. Just roughly speaking, you can see what's going on. So that's time zero, and you detect the incoming thing. And there are various things done. I won't linger on this too long. Detection of the launch. This is from the US side. There must be a corresponding thing, although I don't have the numbers on the Soviet side. So launch by the satellites is detected and has to be sent up within 3/4 of a minute. Then duty offers receive the warning. Then there is a conference done. Immediately a conference started by the people in the detection branch. NORAD command director will re-verify the signal, check for false signals, equipment malfunction, all those things. All that has to be finished in 3 months. So far, only 4 minutes have gone. Then you assess that this is, in fact, a high-confidence event, and you send it up to the bosses, Joint Chairman of Joint Chiefs, who holds unhurried consultations with Defense Secretary, National Security Advisor, and others, before calling up the president. The National Security Advisor's job is to call the president. So then, having called the president is supposed to call a meeting consisting of himself and all these people, where the detection people give him a direct briefing on the satellite signals. Meanwhile, radars in Alaska, Greenland, and so on, confirm that there are launches coming from submarines, if there are any. All this takes, has to be done in 6 minutes, so 6 + 4 = 10, since the thing first left home. Then this conference, headed by the president, decides to launch a counterattack. That decision is given 10 minutes. In which he says, should we do it or should we not, how real it is. Still, 20 minutes have gone. Transmitting the launch orders takes 2 more minutes. Firing of the missiles takes 3 minutes. And you still want to leave yourself 5 minutes for the missiles that you are firing to go beyond the range of the incoming ones. If they just leave the 2 seconds before the other guys drop, even if it's not a direct hit, they will be destroyed. So this is how the time is broken up. This is just to show you the precariousness. The most difficult thing here are these 6 minutes, okay? 6 + 10 = 16. And this is true in any country which wants to do, take some action after launch. And certain countries which are unmentionable are also involved. We all have the same problem. So given the situation, there were many close calls. When, in fact, the fate of all of humanity, in some sense, hung in the balance. I'll just give you 2 examples, one from the Russian side, one from the American side. In 1980, that happened on June 3rd, there were many other incidents. This is the most interesting. The US early warning system, which means the satellites and so on, appeared to detect a huge incoming Soviet attack with 2,200 nuclear missiles. Remember, they had tens of thousands, so 2,200 is very plausible, heading towards US targets. So within minutes, this whole process was put into motion. And Brzezinski, who was the National Security Advisor to Carter, was getting himself ready to notify the president. All the earlier stages had been done. And just a minute before the president, Brzezinski was going to call the president, the North American radar outfit learned that the US radars were not seeing the missiles. Satellites had seen them launch. Then you expect to confirm it by the radar seeing them coming in, and they were not, they don't seem to be coming in. So immediately the retaliatory attack was called off, because unless all these things agreed, it was understood they were not going to retaliate. And the problem turned out to be a malfunctioning chip. It cost 46 cents, and it had to have, it was supposed to have zeros instead of a couple of places, instead of 2 zeros, it had 2 twos. So 000 missiles were coming, it showed it as 2200 missiles, and that was the, this took some days to find out what went wrong. But that is how close you are. One small chick in this elaborate machinery of detectors and missiles and so on can do that. In the Russian side, something similar. In 1995, the Russian early warning radar detected an unexpected missile launch off the coast of Norway. Now, the US is not in the coast of Norway, but the US submarines are all prowling all over the place. So it's entirely possible that this was a US launch. And You could detect the missile, you could see that its flight characteristics were very similar to that of a US submarine-launched ballistic missile. So immediately the Russian forces went on full alert, awaiting the order from Yeltsin to launch a retaliatory strike. Fortunately, again, the early warning satellites did not see these additional launches, the radar saw it. So the Russians decided that decided it's a false alarm. And in fact, the missile was actually a Norwegian scientific rocket to study the Aurora Borealis. It gets off from, it's the same kind of rocket, it takes off from Norway, and it's totally innocent. And there again, it was all detected within those minutes. In fact, here, the rocket went off from the coast of Norway, not from the US, so you had very much fewer minutes. There are other incidents, I don't want to list all of them here, where in fact a very thoughtful, very, very sensible Russian officer on the spot decided not to retaliate, although all the instructions given to him would have asked him to do so. He said, something is wrong, he won't. He's a hero now, he's in here and there, he's fated here and there, and prevented again the catastrophe. Normally, you do court-martial for doing something like that. So there were instances, and such instances of unintended attacks through accidents, misread signals, and instrument failure remained. And more importantly, they remain even today. Because again, in the US now, there are several thousand, by now it's about 1,500 or so, nuclear weapons on missiles sitting in launch sites and all ready to be launched. They are meant to be launched on signal. So there is no time to think. And once you launch these things, you can't call them back. Aeroplanes, you may be able to call back, but missiles, there's no way. Once you launch them, they're gone. They're ballistic. So this was the situation. Let me come back to disarmament. Now, what happened is, while the Russians and the Americans, Soviets were doing all this, some other nations also began to build nuclear weapons. And by 1964, each of the P5, that is the short name for the five countries that are members of the UN Security Council, they have veto votes, they're very powerful. The US, USSR, UK, France, and China, all of them had their own nuclear arsenals by the mid-60s. As you can imagine, when this sort of thing happens, nuclear weapons also became a currency of global power and prestige. USSR and US didn't need the weapons to make themselves known as global powers, but they obviously were, the magnitude of their economies and their military power. But the other countries, their prestige certainly did go up. And if you're going to be a member of the Security Council, it seemed like you should have at least have nuclear weapons, so they did. India was not one of them. This is the P5. And once they all had nukes in their pockets, these five countries, who were Security Council appointed by themselves as guardians of the world, decided, huh, these weapons are dangerous. They shouldn't let other people have them. So they brought into being what's called the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, NPT, which divided the world into two categories, the haves and the have-nots. The haves were the five nuclear weapon states, the P5, who had the weapons, and the rest of us were the non-nuclear weapon states, the have-nots. And the treaty disallowed any of the rest non-nuclear weapon states from acquiring the weapons and created a whole machinery, including the International Atomic Energy Agency, to verify that no country was up to any dirty tricks like that. So this was obviously an asymmetrical treaty, and India wouldn't join it because it was asymmetrical, that's what they said. Of course, we also know now that India wanted to keep its gunpowder dry because they were planning to perhaps do something. So they didn't join the treaty. And of course, if India doesn't join the treaty, Pakistan doesn't join the treaty. There it remained. Israel, of course, is beyond all laws. I mean, they won't even admit there's a nucleus inside an atom, let alone there are weapons and so on. So they have a policy of opacity, it's a stated policy. But despite this huge asymmetry that this non-proliferation treaty had, amazingly, 190 countries signed it. And how did that happen? Well, there were certain carrots that were offered. Amongst the carrots were, one was that the nuclear weapon countries said, look, this only applies to nuclear weapons. We will help you develop nuclear energy. And nuclear power had just come in at that around that time, and it was considered to be the answer to all energy problems. And in television in those days in the US, they show us a small block like this saying, this can light up all of Manhattan, probably holding something made of cork, but it was supposedly uranium, you know, that much uranium can. So everybody was welcoming this great step, and all countries realized that even smaller countries can afford to build a reactor, maybe not a fleet of them. So many, many countries were interested in having civilian nuclear power, and the US guaranteed that it provided for them, in part because US companies were the only ones making it in the West at that time. So the and then the second carrot was that the nuclear weapons states, in certain article of the NPT called Article 6, promised to pursue negotiations amongst themselves to effect, I'm just quoting the words there, effective measures relating to nuclear disarmament and on a treaty on general and complete disarmament. They said, look, this is not forever. Right now, you can't build any weapons, but we are going to give up ours, and we're going to have a very systematic procedure for going towards complete disarmament. So these two things were offered to the other countries. Besides, other things that made NPT acceptable to the non-nuclear weapon countries was that most of them were, in any case, developing nations. At that time, in the 60s up to 70, they didn't have the technological base or the economic strength to go in for nuclear arsenals anyway. So they'd be quite happy to give up that option, especially if they could get other things in return. And then after developed countries, amongst the non-nuclear weapons states, remember that there were lots and lots of developed countries, Scandinavian countries, Germany, and so on, which were not nuclear weapon states. They renounced the nuclear option on principle, but many of them were covered either by the nuclear umbrella of the US through NATO and so on, or of the USSR through the socialist pacts of various kinds. So many of the countries we said, all right, we won't make weapons, were covered. There were a few countries which on principle didn't. New Zealand is one or two others like that. And others who were too weak to make it, that is the developing countries. So they managed to get 190 signatories, so it really became a truly accepted treaty by the world. Was that successful? Has it been successful? Well, in some ways, yes, in some ways, no. Despite its discriminatory aspects, one must admit that the NPT treaty has been very successful in preventing most countries from making these weapons. This is called non-proliferation. It's a big word in that world. Non-proliferation, horizontal proliferation of weapons. And in fact, in the 50 years since NPT came into force, of the 185 non-nuclear weapon signatories, only one has violated it and started building its own arsenal. That is, of course, North Korea. Okay. So the non-nuclear weapon states they've managed to keep the cap on their building nuclear weapons. But the other side of the bargain, that the nuclear weapon states would disarm or start disarming, that was not kept at all. So despite the assurance given in that article of NPT, far from taking effective measures toward disarmament, et cetera, the nuclear weapon state kept increasing their arsenals, okay? And seemed to be making no moves at all towards getting rid of the weapons. And as I said earlier, during the peak of the Cold War, as a result of that, there were about 60,000 weapons on both sides together, roughly half-half, enough to wipe out mankind several times over. But simultaneously around that time, beginning in the late 60s and developing in the early 70s, some thoughtful people, mostly, in fact, scientists in the US and USSR, had set in motion some informal discussions between each other towards some kind of negotiated arms reduction. And there's a long history to it, we don't have the time, nor would it interest you that much, but I'll just list for you the various treaties and the kind of acronyms they had. So we had things called SALT treaties, SALT 1 and SALT 2, which is Strategic Arms Limitations Treaties. Those were in the 70s. 87, we had something called the Intermediate Range Nuclear Forces Treaty called INF, which was in the newspapers in the past year because it's been, both the US and USSR pulled out, Russia pulled out of it. Then there was a Strategic Arms Reduction Treaty, START 1. That lowered the number of warheads by almost a half. And most importantly, that treaty had in it clauses for verifying that the other side has also destroyed its weapons. And then there was another one called SALT in 2002. So a whole bunch of treaties here which were systematically bringing down the numbers. And in pursuance of these treaties, over 40,000 weapons had been consigned for junk, for dismantlement. So out of the 60,000, you came down to about 20,000. 20,000 is still a big number, but it's really a big reduction in terms of what was actually set out for dismantlement. So here's a picture of the kind of things that they did. This is a picture taken by the Russian satellites of planes which are guillotined, as they say. Keep the planes, real planes, because they are not cardboard. Those are the things that the smart spies know, is cardboard or not. And then you chop them from above and just remove the wings. And these are the carcasses of live bombers, and which you could see from the other satellite that it has happened. This is an example of the level of verification that they permitted. So there was a great deal of give and take of classified information, while there was also a great deal of protection of classified information. That's why intelligence is an important part of keeping peace, properly used. Spies are an important part of keeping peace.
So is this what they call it as the Arabian graveyard or something?
Yeah, this is one of the graveyards. Yeah, this is one of the graveyards. There are several like that. But after that 2002 treaty, which is the last one I showed, there was no movement towards further arms control between the US and Russia. Meanwhile, some other countries besides the P5 had also started developing weapons: Israel, India, Pakistan, and more recently, North Korea. Israel had begun its program very early, already in the 60s, and the French had helped them conduct tests quietly. India and Pakistan openly declared their plans through the 1998 tests, and the preparation, as we all know, had been going on for some time before that. And North Korea pulled out of NPT in 2003, started building its weapons program. By now, it has about 24 weapons. Biggest one of them is a 120 kiloton thermonuclear weapon, something that we don't have. We've been trying to, they have them. None of these nations, apart from the two big principal ones, none of them has shown any desire to give up its arsenal of nuclear weapons. So at the moment, some are no longer building some are building some, but nobody is talking about bringing it down. They're talking about it, but nobody is doing anything about bringing it down. In this kind of situation where new countries had joined the nuclear club and nobody was showing signs of getting rid of them, there was a brief period of hope. This hope started, strangely enough, by actually an op-ed written in the Wall Street Journal by four people called Sam Nunn, George Shultz, Bill Perry, and Henry Kissinger. Most people would know Kissinger's name. Shultz and Perry were all secretaries to the government. George Shultz was secretary to Reagan, and he almost had full disarmament in a little meeting that he and Reagan and Gorbachev had in Iceland or somewhere. So these are all people who had held. Sam Nunn was the chairman of the Armed Services Committee of Senate, and that is bigger than any secretary. So these are very senior people in the US establishment. These were not pacifists, these were not activists, these were all people who were the highest level next to the president in the US. They wrote an article, and they were called the Four Horsemen. You know, immediately they pick up names, they're called the Four Horsemen, and some other people called them the Gang of Four, but they prefer the Four Horsemen, so stick with that. And they called for reversing the reliance on nuclear weapons globally, these four American statesmen, and ultimately ending them as a threat to the world. Very nice. They recommended further disarmament by the US and the USSR and work towards a world without any nuclear weapons. The Americans were saying this. This call was published in the Wall Street Journal. A year later, they published a revised version, meaning saying they really meant it, giving more details. And coming from former American leaders who in their heyday had actually presided over thousands of nukes, and especially Dr. Kissinger, who nobody would mistake for being a pacifist, being an author of this article, it took everybody by surprise. And they were in fact hailed all over the world and wined and dined, including in Delhi. But the motive behind this joint appeal was in fact not pacifism. And that would have been surprising. It was not. It was based on pragmatic and very cynical considerations. As I read it, one reason was, firstly, a condescending view of our part of the world. They were not sure that these guys can handle nuclear weapons. And that is there in one of the paragraphs which they have. The US and the Soviet Union, say these four gentlemen, were diligent enough to ensure that no nuclear weapon was used during the Cold War, either by design or by accident. But will new nuclear weapon states be as fortunate? That's diplomats talking for you, which means they will not be as fortunate. They may not have the capability. There were other sentences in there which doubted the capability of the newer countries to not have accidentally a war. There were also fears at that time of more nations turning nuclear, particularly Iran and Korea, which were viewed by the West as their worst enemies of that time. So the Americans, these gentlemen, were concerned about these people getting a hold of nuclear weapons. And besides, a new perspective had started to emerge around that time about nuclear weapons generally, It became obvious, it was obvious to many people even before that, but even by established military leaders and so on around the world, it became obvious these are not weapons you're ever going to use. You're not really going to drop this weapon anywhere. They realized that that is their road to nowhere. So many in the felt, in the military, many countries felt there's no advantage at all to non-usable weapons like this. From time to time, there would be clamor in the US from the military saying, look, don't make more weapons, give us money for better airplanes, better, more tanks, more this, more bullets or whatever. So the approach towards nuclear weapons began to change as purely political instruments and not as military instruments. There was also the post 9/11 fear of nuclear terrorism, which contributed to this move. Particularly the West, which had suffered 9/11, they wanted to ensure that the materials and know-how for making nuclear weapons not be allowed to spread. The US was also confident that they would be safer and better off if nobody had nukes, including themselves, because they had such a massive conventional military superiority. They wanted to go back to the old days when they could have won anything. They didn't need nuclear weapons. They wanted to get back to that state where the danger of terrorists getting hold of weapons or the Iranians and so on would not be there. So this was the motivation behind these articles. So these four horsemen felt that it may be better that everyone, including the superpowers, give up their nukes rather than permit more people to develop them. But then there came another horseman. He was not called a horseman. He galloped even faster, and that was President Obama. And he was a person who genuinely wanted to get rid of nuclear weapons, as far as I can tell. One doesn't know what to do. And he had already stated these as part of a presidential campaign promise in 2008, but a dangerous thing to do. No presidential candidate ever campaign with that as one of his planks. And unlike most campaign promises made around the world, Obama tried to keep his promise. Okay? He had talked about it openly and everywhere. There was a very famous speech within a few months of his inauguration in Prague. It's called the Prague speech, calling for a world without nuclear weapons. It was, in my view, one of his most inspiring speeches. And here's a sentence from it. That the existence of thousands of nuclear weapons is the most dangerous legacy of the Cold War. I state clearly and with conviction America's commitment to seek the peace and security of a world without nuclear weapons. Lots of people have said that. No US president, let alone a sitting one, not even a past one. Jimmy Carter came closest to that, but here was a president saying it within the first year of inauguration. So once the US president in office, and also such a popular US president when he first became president, said this, the world sort of is willing to shake itself out of its stupor. And led by, for the first time, by US president in office, the vision of a nuclear-free world was quickly endorsed by other nations. Everybody wanted to praise Obama. And importantly, Medvedev of Russia, who was temporarily the president because Putin had given him the kursi on the grounds they give it back in 5 years. Medvedev was there then. He was a somewhat softer person. He also joined Obama in the call for nuclear disarmament. And there were any number of places where press conferences given by these two gentlemen side by side saying, we want a world without nuclear weapons. Something like this couldn't have been imagined a few years earlier. And in particular, the last treaty to bring down the numbers was expiring. And Obama reached out to Medvedev, and together they negotiated what is called the New START Treaty of continuing with the reduction of nuclear weapons. And that New START Treaty, which is the best so far, has had reduced the number of strategic weapons down to 700 delivery vehicles and 1550 warheads. There are the missiles, there are the warheads, missiles and planes, and these numbers are now, you can see, have come down drastically. This is not the total number of bombs, there are any number of other things which are kept but not destroyed. And then also there are the non-strategic weapons which are called tactical nuclear weapons. Maybe question hour I can try to explain that. But you know, these are very major achievements in terms of purely negotiating achievements. I mean, the nuclear treaty was nothing compared to this. Because it not only do you have to negotiate every little detail as to when you're going to do how and how to verify, even if you decide to dismantle a weapon, it takes 3 days. In one of these think tanks, I met a lady who actually used to do that. Sitting there, she'd be sent a message. She was one of people in a long assembly line. She would unscrew this and pass it on, like in an assembly chain, except that it's a disassembly chain. And she said, it takes 3 days per weapon. And if you have 10,000 weapons or 20,000 weapons to get rid of, you can see how complex it is. And then it's all very dangerous. So that previous graph that I showed you now can be modified to 2015. That was the peak that I talked about, and then steadily coming down, partly because of the arms treaties and partly because of Obama and so on. There are two curves here. The upper curve corresponds to weapons which have been pulled off from the firing line. Of them, some have been dismantled, some haven't been in this undismantled. And if you just take the undismantled one, the number is really like that.
Okay. This is pointing.
Yeah.
If you, in that curve, it's clear that under the Bush administration, the rate of reduction was actually much faster than Obama. So I would actually...
George Bush administration.
The Bush, second Bush.
George W. Bush.
So which would suggest that, in fact, Obama was motivated by many of the same cynical concerns that the
Obama. Well, I must say that Obama was not successful in doing that. That much I agree. My sense is that he probably was not, because everybody was rooting for it. Bush was before Obama, no? Yeah, and it increased at that time. No, Father Bush had done something. Father Bush had brought the numbers down. Yeah, but you know, the actual coming down of weapons and the treaties leading to them, there is a big gap in time between them. So some of the reduction process, George W. Bush, the father, was in fact very much, he in fact voluntarily, unilaterally reduced certain weapons, got rid of certain weapons. But it takes time for the numbers to come down. So what you observe here is true, but that is because of time lag between policy and actual reduction in the number. Now, of course, this 15, 16,000 sounds inconsistent with the fact that the treaty allowed only 1550 deployed warheads each for US and Russia. The remaining weapons were a small number were with the other nuclear weapon countries. They were a relatively small number. All the other nuclear nations add up to about 1500 weapons. Okay. So the remaining 12,000 are still weapons. They are still there in the US. They are either tactical weapons and not put on top of ICBMs or undeployed weapons, you know. So the actual number is not 16,000 and not 1550 times two. Okay, so this is the actual count of how many warheads there are, either in the storeroom or sitting on missiles in between the two countries. And about 1500 of them are from other countries of the world. So this is the situation, and their breakup. Oops, excuse me. Yeah. One second. Just have to go to ensure. How do I get the cursor? Yeah, good. Thank you very much. Right. So this is the breakup of today's situation, more or less. US has about, they both have approximately 8,000. US is a little less than Russia. And most of the extra ones that Russia has are tactical weapons, short-range weapons. Then all the other countries you can see are the order of a few hundred. France is less than 200. The country which has done maximum amount of reduction actually is UK. They've been doing it before anybody else. Right now, the UK has only one submarine at sea carrying a certain number of missiles, a couple of more on shore, but only one at any given time on sea, and that's it. They have no planes carrying weapons, they have no missiles. They really brought the thing down, not so much again because of idealism, but because of costs and budget problems. And here are the India-Pakistan numbers and so on. These numbers are written down. I want to say something about these numbers. In this panel of fissile materials I'm involved in, we tried to predict these numbers. It's very, very hard. You don't really know. So what we used to do, we used to get information on how much plutonium and weapon uranium any given country has. How do we get that? Well, you know the reactors, you know the design, if you know some reactor physics, you know how long it's been running, and there is a certain amount of plutonium deposited in the rods per kilowatt hour or gigawatt hour it produces. So you could make an estimate of how much plutonium must have accumulated. That gives you an upper limit of how many bombs they could have made. So that's all we could do. And the errors in our things which we showed in our documents were plus or minus 30%, because we couldn't really be sure. And when people in the Indian thing would come and make laugh at us, say, ah, you guys don't even know to plus or minus 30%, I tell them, tell me. I'll put the correct number in. Of course, they're not going to tell me. So that was that. So how did these guys, this is given by different group, Christensen and so on, how did these guys get these numbers? For a long time, I was unhappy with this fact, and I couldn't arouse my colleagues to worry about it. It turns out that these numbers are not number of bombs. there are a number of missiles. Missiles are very easy to find out, big, large thing. And any time a country adds a missile, the world knows about it. So they count the number of missiles, they assume one per missile, and that's how they tell you how many bombs there are. They also count every aeroplane as one, although you can put six in a bomber. So these are not exactly the number of warheads. That is why when people suddenly get all upset and start telephoning saying, we've just heard Pakistan has 10 more weapons than India, that's not kya hone wala hai, and so on. You tell them, first of all, nobody knows whether that is true or not. So this, I would call this as a ballpark figure. One can say there are about a little over 100 in both countries. And I don't know who has more and who has less. South Korea is about less than 10. At the time this was made, it's grown to 20 now. So they're rapidly making more and more weapons. So this is the world situation right now. Still, from 60,000 to 16,000 is a good development. So far, so good. What comes next in the road towards zero? The two superpowers, meanwhile, have been pressurizing the smaller countries. India has always been at the receiving end of this pressure, saying, first, don't make weapons, and having made them, cut them down. Don't make fissile materials, and so forth. But in vain, nobody listens to them. They have not succeeded. And the countries which are making, wanting to make things, are continuing to make them. But that's not surprising, because these two superpowers have absolutely no moral authority to ask anyone else to bring down the weapons. They still have thousands in their hands. And to demand other nations which have only a few hundreds to dissolve, they have no moral authority. You and I may have a moral authority, we have no weapons, but those countries have none. So that made no progress at all. In fact, the only thing that could possibly make a progress towards total disarmament is if these two major countries, even though they've done a spectacular job in bringing the numbers down from 60,000 to 16,000, unless they bring it down further, there is no hope of other countries paying attention to calls for disarmament. Even if everybody agreed to disarm, the process of disarming so that everyone is carefully watching whether the other person has done it or not, very complex process. Scholars are writing articles about how they would do this and so forth. So, but there is no question if the US and USSR arsenals still continue to remain in thousands. In fact, for a long time I've been saying, why don't they bring it down to 999? It's a trick from American merchandising. So, because there's three numbers and not four. And that will have a psychological effect, but they are nowhere near there. Is it likely between now and I'm talking about the future, there could be more rounds of bilateral arms reduction, bringing the numbers to below 1,000 each? The prospects for that, unfortunately, are very grim. And I'll show you a few slides about this, then I'm done. So, the way it looks now, Obama's first term, his second term was not very helpful in this. First term seems to have been the high point of hopes for disarmament. Since then, the policies and actions of both the superpowers have been regressive in this, from this point of view. Examples of this. So the world nuclear situation is certainly more dangerous now than it was 6-7 years ago. And it's not entirely Trump. There's more to it than that. There was this example. There was a treaty called INF Treaty. This has been in the papers for the past 1 year. It banned all nuclear missiles of less than a certain range, which means the so-called tactical missiles. These tactical missiles were introduced by the Soviets and by the Americans to be put in Europe so that if there's an attack from a Soviet bloc country on a NATO country, these missiles will be used by these countries to fight with each other. Meanwhile, the big boys are far away. This was the whole point of the tactical missiles. And they were banned by 1987 treaty. So it was a very big improvement, because that was the most dangerous situation when some sitting in Poland, some sitting in East Germany and so on could be fired. By and large, the authority was in the hands of the US and USSR, but it's not completely clear how much authority was there in the hands of the local strategic people. So getting rid of them or banning them was a very major step forward, and that was the Intermediate Range Missile Nuclear Forces Treaty. It was signed in 87 by Reagan and Gorbachev. Reagan, in his old age, turned out to be very, very pacific in these matters. And Gorbachev was Gorbachev. So it has led considerably to the stability in Europe as one of the factors that goes into EU having become what it became, having socialist countries in it. Now, what happened is that even before this, there are these anti-ballistic missiles about which you might have heard, of which there is talk in India also, which are things you used to shoot down incoming missiles. The US and USSR from the beginning knew that if you developed anti-missile, then I can't fire my missiles at you. Then I have to have two for every one that you have, and this is going to be catastrophic. So they had a treaty, US and USSR, saying we shall not make anti-missile ballistic missiles. So it's an ABM treaty saying, all right, you make offensive weapons, but please don't make defensive weapons because the cost will go up for all of us. And they sensibly agreed on this. Okay? So there was an ABM treaty between US and USSR. But the US pulled out of the ABM treaty. And why did they pull out? Because they were worried about North Koreans who were developing things over there, and they wanted to use an anti-ballistic missile system in Alaska to prevent the stop anything coming from North Korea. And tiny little North Korea, but even one is bad enough, so they were worried about it. They wanted to set up an ABM system, and if they want to do it, they'll pull out of any treaty, and that's what they did. They pulled out of this treaty. And they also were worried about Iran. Iran still doesn't have missiles which can come anywhere near the US, but they're always worried about Iran. And so they set up some anti-ballistic missile systems in Poland, which is now outside the socialist bloc, again to intercept the Iranian missiles. So they have some in Alaska to intercept North Korean missiles and some in Poland to intercept Iranian missiles. But you see, Poland is not that far away from Russia. So Russians worried that the anti-ballistic systems that they have in Poland just be turned around and stop missiles coming out of Russia. So the Russians began to build then new missiles, violating the earlier treaty, short-range ones, to target the US anti-ballistic missile sites in Poland. They wanted to get rid of them because this is threatening their own offensive capability. So when the US heard about it, got very upset itself, then if you're violating the INF treaty, so I'm pulling out of it. And the Russians said, okay, you pull out of it, I'll pull off it too. Neither country was very keen to not have the freedom to build smaller range missiles. So on August 2nd, 2019, this treaty expired. First time that a treaty that was going towards more peaceful situation was dropped by both countries. And the death of this treaty foreshadows not only a new competition now to build these long banned weapons, but also endangers other arms control treaties. Nothing is sacred. So already, therefore, the Russians are saying, well, this New START treaty that Medvedev and Obama negotiated to bring down the number of warheads, they said, well, I don't know, maybe we'll pull out of that too. So it has started things going in the wrong direction. Then the word phrase used in the strategic communities that the nuclear order is coming apart. It is funny kind of nuclear order. I mean, it's pro some people, anti some. But what there was is slowly also unraveling. Similarly, the Russians on their side, they annexed Crimea. They had conflicts in Ukraine and Syria, which put the backs up of Europeans and Americans. There was accusations that Russia attempted to influence US elections. I don't know what the facts are, but the impression was there. And meanwhile, Putin has become more muscular in his latest avatar. I mean, he's been president, been non-president, been president. And now, under his leadership, there's much more support for a more masculine Russia. And there is less appetite for arms reduction and cooperation. They feel in siege. And the US, in turn, is imposing sanctions on them. So things are getting bad there. In fact, Putin, in his last Federal Assembly speech, which is equivalent to the State of the Union speech here and so on, the US, he described an extensive nuclear modernization program. That's the phrase they use. They say, we're not building more weapons, just making them more modern. That means one new weapon could probably do twice the damage of an old one, and so forth. You have to keep the nuclear scientists happy, you know, because they have a huge complex there, not military industrial, just governmental complex, which will all go out of jobs if you're going to stop making weapons. So you tell them, all right, you can clean the existing weapons. You're allowed to do that. Improvement, protection. There are various phrases for that. I don't remember them now. So both Russia and the US is putting in huge amounts of money now to replace and refurbish and remodel their existing weapons, keeping the numbers the same. And the latest nuclear policy review of the US, which is the analog of our nuclear doctrines, is much more aggressive than any earlier thing. Until then, as I said, the fact that everybody was generally in agreement that nuclear weapons are not war-fighting instruments and hopefully will never be used in a conflict. And in fact, a tacit taboo has been around since Hiroshima and Nagasaki, that no matter what, nobody's going to use a nuclear weapon in anger. But this view is slowly changing now. In the nuclear policy review, the U.S. plans to supplement the U.S. existing arsenal to expand the range of credible U.S. options. These are all loaded words. Credible means things you can actually use. To include low-yield weapons, there's somehow a feeling that a small nuclear weapon chal jayega without having the world's wrath on your shoulders. Small nuclear weapons, and respond also to non-nuclear strategic attacks. That is, they may hit you back even if you don't hit them with nuclear, but you hit them with conventional things. So here's the phrase, US would only consider deployment. We're talking about no first use. India has a policy of no first use. Americans have never had that policy. Pakistanis have never had that policy. The Americans have always said all options are on the table. That's the phrase that they use. And now they're elaborating on this. US would consider deployment only in extreme circumstances. Well, what are they? Significant non-nuclear strategic attacks, which means you don't have to hit them with nuclear weapons. You could just have a conventional war with them on the US or on its allies or on its partners or on their civilian populations or their infrastructure. So the number of things you can do to invite the nuclear wrath of the US has largely grown in this latest nuclear policy document. In fact, one of my friends, who's a very good analyst, points out that in theory, if you take this language seriously, you know, Yemen could attack Saudi Arabian airport. Neither of them is a nuclear power. And the US on the grounds of Saudi Arabia as an ally and their infrastructure is being attacked can immediately nuke Yemen. According to this, it's allowed to do so. Previous policies would never, no, not that they're going to do it, but this is how the rhetoric grows up, and with that, the danger grows up. And other friends of ours, Fetter, Garvin, and Warnapel point out another very important feature. These nuclear systems designed to increase the lives of weapons, which are meant to, I forget the word now, modernization programs, are intended so that the weapons will last for another 40 years. The fact that they are doing this and they're setting up all the infrastructure for doing this means they clearly don't think there'll be any disarmament for 40 years. So forget about road to nuclear zero and so on and so forth. At least for the next 40 years, the US is not thinking at all in that direction. So these are all negative developments. The only positive development has been the so-called nuclear ban treaty. It's called the ban treaty for short. It's a treaty on the prohibition of nuclear weapons. It was passed just a couple of years in the UN General Assembly. And it's the first legally binding international agreement to comprehensively prohibit nuclear weapons. So the countries that signed to it are prohibited from developing them, testing them, producing them, stockpiling them, stationing them, transferring them, using and threat of use of nuclear weapons, all that is banned, as well as assistance and encouragement to these activities by others. So it's a very broad brush of bad things which you should not do, this ban treaty. And for countries which are already nuclear armed, which cannot do this, it provides for a time-bound program for them to get rid of their weapons. But the problem is that in order for this treaty to come into effect, it needs 50 countries to sign it and 25 already signed it. So it's in all likelihood the treaty will come into force. You know, when they make these treaties, they give it some time. If enough countries sign it, only then it becomes. So for instance, the Comprehensive Test Ban Treaty, which says we will not test nuclear weapons, has not gone through because not enough countries have signed it. So, but the problem with this ban treaty, as you can imagine, no nuclear weapon country has expressed support for it. So all the chaps who don't have nuclear weapons have all supported it. The US and UK, in fact, issued a joint statement saying this is all irresponsible talk. They don't intend to sign, ratify, or ever become a party to the ban treaty. Our people, they didn't even participate in the treaty negotiation. None of the nuclear powers participated in it. Even country like Japan, whose significance you know in the nuclear contest, under the protection of the US nuclear forces, wanted to not hurt the nuclear process. They stayed out of the treaty. And in fact, there are statements, if you research now, you go and see various Japanese people saying, we are against nuclear weapons, they have done damage to us, nobody else has suffered the way we have, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But we don't want them banished, because we like the protection we are getting from them against their own version of bad guys, Chinese, the North Koreans, and so on. Japanese have not started making nuclear weapons or seriously made any effort, but there are voices in Japan in the civilian nuclear world of theirs saying, well, you know, if you want to get rid of all the reactors, what will happen if someday we want to have a bomb? So that kind of talk is beginning to happen. The only state, surprisingly, which supported the ban on nuclear negotiations was North Korea, because it felt if everybody removes the weapons, they'll be better off. They're having a really difficult time because all their money is going into it. So with no traction with the countries that matter, the impact of the ban treaty is limited. For instance, many years ago, Rajiv Gandhi, I think genuinely, wanted to have a nuclear disarmament treaty. He and Olaf Palme and so on had a nuclear disarmament plan. But of course, it made no impact at all. None of the six countries had nuclear weapons. So the big countries said, ha, 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 paid no attention to it. So these things have an effect only if you have it and you say, I'm getting rid of it. If you say everybody get rid of Mercedes-Benz and you don't even have one, nobody's going to pay any attention to what you're saying. You know? So things are bad, as this doomsday clock, which I mentioned, to summarize the situation as follows, and I agree with every word. Reliance on nuclear weapons appears to be growing now. At one time, it is coming down. Military doctrines are evolving in ways that increase the focus instead of decreasing it on nuclear weapons. So the road to nuclear zero has again been stretched beyond the horizon, and I don't know when it'll happen, if ever. Thank you.
Thank you for that very illuminating talk. Questions? Yes,
so small comment. So, of course, many more countries have signed the EPNW. I think it's 25 have ratified it, but I think 70 or 80 have signed
it. Signed it, but they have not ratified it. That's right.
And of,
correct.
Some of the negotiators said was that countries like China, for example, were much more supportive, and of course, the US, UK, and France have very interesting
right
position. So, that might be hopeful. Some more optimism, because their stated aim was at least to try and outlaw nuclear weapons the same way that chemical weapons have been outlawed.
Yes. Yes.
And so at some point the idea was that it's
demonized. Absolutely. Sure. Absolutely. Yeah. That is the intention. And yeah. And people have put in a huge amount of work to make this happen. So one hopes so. But we have to wait and see. Yeah.
Good. Yeah. You said at some point there was an SSC8 which the US used as an excuse to withdraw from the ICTS.
Yeah.
Of course, the Russians claim that this missile there is in compliance with the ICTS. And so the US says it's not in compliance, but that might just be an excuse. Is there any publicly available evidence that you know of that say it states that this
no.
is actually not in compliance?
No, not in detail, I don't know. But people in the US, like Ted Postal and so on, say that yes, it does violate it. They say the US had also violated it. That argument I've heard many people say, that Russia is not the only country that has violated INF before pulling out. US has also done things which violate the treaty. But generally, it seems to be agreed, looking at the distances and so on, that probably the Russians also. They were tacitly agreed by both countries that this treaty has to go. That's my feeling. So, yeah. Excuse me. What are the countries? Well, as far as I know, we are one. Chinese are another. As far as I know, these are the only two that have adopted it, explicitly come and said so. There is a moratorium on various things, but that's not the same thing as a policy like this. So these are the only two countries which have said so, of the six or seven, eight that are there.
Does the argument, so I have heard these arguments against nuclear power as well. Does it try into nuclear zero in any sense?
Not really. Well, ultimately, if you come anywhere near zero, suppose you come to a stage where every country has only 10 or 20, and you're coming down to zero, that is the most critical period, because even if one country is left with one, it is an enormous advantage over others. So at that time, therefore, long before that, you firstly have to get rid of all fissile material. Because if you have them lying around loose, it takes no time at all to make a bomb. So many such things have to be done, and the impact of that on nuclear power will be considerable. Whether nuclear power itself will die a natural death or not depends on other factors like cost, the cost of other sources of renewable resources being much lower and so forth. This will have an impact because of the fissile material angle. But the philosophy behind the two is different. So the guys who oppose nuclear weapons are not all the guys who oppose nuclear power. Yeah.
What happened to this pragmatic, cynical strain of thinking that you mentioned,
Four horsemen? Well, it was taken forward by Obama, and he found there are no takers in the Senate or Congress, and that's been dropped.
So you listed several pragmatic, cynical reasons.
Yeah.
So those don't have any traction?
Have no traction with the rest of the world. So their hope was that they were making a statement, and this meant that nobody else will have them and so on, and they didn't say very much about how this was going to proceed. So nothing much came out of it. What it did was it made it plausible for Obama to come out in his campaign and talk about no nuclear weapons as if it's an extension of what they had said. But nothing much has happened. They have not withdrawn their statement, but nothing, no movement at all from that.
So you mentioned this. What happened to this dismantled weapons?
Yeah.
Are they kept in some kind of cold storage?
Well, no, you have to first dismantle them. Then what is left behind, apart from metal pieces and so on and so forth, and conventional explosives, which are very strong, are the cores, the plutonium core. And those have to be just stored, so it won't die, it won't rot. So the part of the storage of materials, including fuel rods from reactors and so on, along with that you also have these all have to be stored somewhere. And that's part of this. Right now they're all stored in military facilities, but eventually they have to be stored somewhere. Nothing can be done about them. Uranium, highly enriched uranium, you can do something. There is uranium, ordinary uranium from the ground. That is not really fissile. It contains a small amount of U-235, which is fissile. And to make weapons, you have to enrich it to have much larger amount of U-235. So all the uranium sitting in bombs has 90% of U-235. What you can do is to dilute that by adding water. That is, add a lot of ordinary uranium, downgrade it. Then it's no longer weapon worthy, and in fact is reactor worthy. So what one of the things they did, one of the sensible things that they did during the period when relations between the US and USSR were good, that the US organized the Russians to use some of their enriched uranium from their disarmed vehicles, disabled bombs, and downgrade it and sell it to the US. And the US then used that to run reactors. And the thing took on this name, you know, from megatons to megawatts program. And that really successfully worked. In fact, at one stage, 10% of the US electricity came from using in the US reactors the downgraded uranium from the, and 500 tons of uranium were, in fact. So uranium, you can do something. Plutonium, there's not a thing you can do. Other than dilute, add other things to it, mix it with dirt, so to speak. But, and its lifetime is 24,000 years, so, yeah.
So does the policy for disarmament also address the rehabilitation of people who were actually working for the program?
Well, it depends on which rehabilitation. If you talk, rehabilitation of people who were hit by nuclear weapons was for the Nagasaki, Hiroshima.
So people had jobs, right? Like for working for the development of nuclear weapons.
The nuclear power is different from nuclear weapon. I want to make that distinction.
Nuclear
weapons, they took fair amount of care. And if there are people who are affected by it, it's simply not in the public realm. So I'm not able to tell you. Nuclear reactors, very much this thing is in the public realm. People are worried about it and written about it and so on. Nuclear weapons, whether they were or not, I'm not sure. Certainly nothing is known in the public about anything happened to any of them. But you know, things like mining and so on are not directly involved with that. You mine it for reactors anyway. So it's only the process of enrichment. In fact, most weapons nowadays don't use uranium. They use plutonium. So there must have been some people who here and there who were injured, but one doesn't hear about them at all. They're deep inside the weapon complex.
The ballpark figure that you're saying, that the uncertainty in Israel's number was around 100 to 200. Mm. Like the Indian Pakistan is about 10.
Well, because Israel won't talk. One doesn't know how much power they reduce.
They have.
As I said, they don't even. They disagree that there are nuclei. So one doesn't know the numbers. That's why the uncertainty is in terms of knowledge. In the case of Russia, in the early days, we had an uncertainty of 300 tons when we were trying to. That is because the Russians themselves didn't know. They were making uranium all over the place. And lots of it stuck in pipes and tubes here and there. So even though we had some very good friends in our panel who were Russians, who had some idea, but this could not. And gradually that uncertainty of 300 tons of Russian HEU has come down to about 100 tons now. But 100 tons is a huge thing. So it takes 25 kilograms to make a weapon. So one ton you make 40. 100 tons, you can imagine. So that's a huge uncertainty. And before any kind of audit is done to bring the numbers down to zero, all this will have to be straightened out. So that is the reason for the Russian one. The Israeli one simply because they won't tell. And they like ambiguity, they believe in ambiguity. So.
Is there a way, for example, if a country is being accused of enriching anyone for military purpose, is there a way that international community can credibly verify it?
Oh yes, that's what's been happening with Iran. That's the whole.
But Iran, like US says that they do, and they say that I
don't. No. Everybody agrees that they do. Everybody now agrees. IAEA has verified, they themselves say we've done it. And now they are saying we're going to go back and do it because the thing is breaking. So that is relatively easy to find out. In the beginning, you couldn't. One didn't know that Iran was in that sort of activity. There was, in fact, a rival group inside Iran that squealed on them and told IAEA, you know, these guys are building something. Then immediately, of course, US satellites went up and checked that, in fact, they were having uranium enrichment plants under the thing. So IAEA is there precisely for this purpose. It has been inspecting Iran even before that, but there are levels and levels of IAEA inspections. Earlier ones, you declare something to be a nuclear facility, then they can come in and look at your facility to make sure that you are not misusing the uranium. Nowadays, there are in the safeguards of higher levels of protocol where they can begin to look at places you have not named and say, hey, I want to look and see there. So now the level of inspection has gone up considerably from the pre-Iranian days. So at that time, the Iranians were doing it in some corner of Iran, in Natanz, not even a corner, big city there. And the IAEA was not invited to see, so they didn't know it. And once it was pointed out, of course, they went there. So there is a procedure. In India, many of our reactors are now under safeguards. As part of the nuclear deal, a certain number are under safeguards. And any reactor we build with foreign collaboration will be under safeguards. The IAEA will come in. It'll be constant watch, and with which everybody is generally sort of agreed. And
so, over time, how do you see the change in the possibility of non-nation states getting hold of has it increased? I mean, or is it just a scare that people think, or is it a very?
No, I think it's largely a scare. It is very difficult to make a nuclear weapon, mainly because it's difficult to get the fissile materials. You can make the electronics in a shed or whatever. You need very clever people, but the space you need is not that much. And so you can quietly do it in some corner, some large enough basement for the rest of the bomb. But producing the fissile material takes huge football field type places because you need 10,000 centrifuges. Iran had 19,000 by the time they were and detected.
People say of maybe ex-Soviet Union, some things, whatever.
Yeah, but they've all, yeah. You have to get hold of that facility. And assuming that the states are not cooperating, you can't get hold of a Russian facility at all. I don't know if that's what.
That's
right. You can't get hold of that much uranium, you see. You need 25 kilograms. So countries are worried. That's why there is policing all over the place. And people were worried, in fact, when the Soviet Union broke down. Because when the Soviet Union broke down, they were so hard up for money. Their nuclear cities, as they call them, they are dedicated cities for nuclear activities. They couldn't pay their salaries. And things were very bad, and morale was very low. And that was the time when outsiders were worried that people would go in there, steal their scientists, steal their materials, so on. And the US was sensible about that. They immediately gave, through various deals, money to Russia so that it can ride over these problems and bring the security down. So that was the time when there was a danger. But even then, to cart a weapon-worthy amount of uranium, you'll have to steal the fissile material. You can't make it. So the most dangerous thing is for somebody to steal existing fissile material. Either plutonium takes only this much and uranium takes this much. To make a bomb, and you can hide that, except for radioactivity and so on. That danger is there. If that danger is there, probably the non-state group can find the expertise to do the electronics, the focusing of the shock wave, and all those things that it takes to make a bomb. But stealing a ready-made bomb is unlikely. And the most dangerous possibility is in Pakistan because of the Taliban. The Pakistan state is not going to allow this. I mean, they are no more interested in terrorists taking hold of weapon than we are or anyone else's. So they are very carefully kept in rings and rings of security. and the Taliban may be able to break open the front gate of the military complex as they've done once or twice. You know, have a bomb attack and the front gate is broken open, but the bombs are not there. So they are kept in considerable secrecy. And the military is highly aware of the problem of separatists. I mean, separatists is a word coming from somewhere else, sorry. Of jihadis getting hold of the bomb. And when Mr. Ziaul Haq was president, he, you know, changed the tenor there a lot. There lots of new madrasas were opened, and the graduates of those madrasas were entered into the army. So there's a large number of fundamentalists, but not necessarily violent, or fundamentalists has grown in Pakistan. But fundamentalism is not wrong. In America, if somebody is a church-going person, is considered a great thing. You trust the man, he goes to church every Sunday. Whereas if a Muslim in Pakistan or anywhere else grows a beard, he says, I'm growing a beard. This is, so part of this is just nonsense. Nevertheless, the Pakistanis know all that. So they say we can't condemn every person just because he begins to do namaz five times a day, which he never used to do before, because maybe he's just turned religious. So it's not an easy problem to find out who is really dangerous and who is just being a devout Muslim in the ranks of the military. So they keep a lookout for this from what they have told me in track two and so on.
How much credible are the current talks between India and Pakistan? There's a lot of things about using
Not much, no. There is only about, there are some understandings about you don't attack certain of my facilities and I don't attack yours. Beyond that, there is no conversation. There never really has been a conversation.
The random public statements are
That's just talk. That's just talk. Absolutely talk. And that is what is misleading think tanks in the US, some of whom make their money by saying India and Pakistan are dangerous places. How else you get your grants? To saying, oh, these guys are going to fight. Look at them. They're irresponsible anyway, these natives. So this talk promotes that kind of talk there. But it does not really imply any serious intention on the part of any responsible groups on either side. They'll make threats. We are very good at that. Mar de gay, and so on. But in actual fact, I don't think there's any threat. Yes. Rajesh, you, yeah, please.
Yeah, please.
He's the boss.
Not just having the nuclear weapons, but it has been sort of
Pakistan
has been known now that initially people used to think only the president has the nuclear codes, but that's sort of proven to be false now that maybe hundreds of people in top ministry and other politicians have access to the nuclear codes in some partial of
power. I don't believe that is so, but let you, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I recently read in a book by Daniel Ellsberg who said that.
Oh, in the US, you mean, or here?
Even here. Like he was saying that the strict secrecy that only the president has the code is not really true. So, how much has it been talked about? Does political instability kind of. Was a much greater threat just by knowing the codes?
No, first of all, I don't. The code is the ultimate thing, and I don't think really that many people know it. That's what's kept in the so-called secret, that suitcase that they carry around. And I don't know, Ellsberg, of course, is a reputed man, but I've never heard such a thing, that it's available. A lot of people are involved in various aspects of the bomb building. It's a huge thing. You need all kinds of people, and there are also strategic experts. They were passed. Generals and past Air Force chiefs, all of them at one time or the other, known various things. But these codes are changed constantly, and nobody can get their hands on them, except the current person who's in charge of the command, the nuclear command. So I don't believe that is so. I think it's not so bad.
So, coming back to the no first use policy, is it out of principle or pragmatic?
Well, sort of. Right, both. See, as soon as we exploded the weapon, we expected massive amount of recrimination from the rest of the world. And one of the things one did at that time to bring that down was to say, look, we have no intention of attacking anybody else. Our arsenal is meant to only protect us from being attacked by those guys. And so we declared a new no-first policy.
But Pakistan is not
against. Because Pakistan from the beginning has said that their nuclear weapons are in part meant to stop our conventional attacks. They have said so clearly. They say, you are a huge big country with a huge big army. You just dismembered a part of us and called it Bangladesh. So we don't know. So our nuclear weapons are to protect us from that also. So they clearly are not no first use. And that's their point of view. It's entirely up to them to decide that. India did say that. It's mostly a diplomatic move. But it goes along with the general tenor of non-violence to which we believe we, you know, we don't kill people and so on, except when you kill people. But so, yeah, so I think it is largely a diplomatic move and a good diplomatic move.
So do you see that? How long is it?
Oh, I don't see that being threatened at all. You lose nothing by saying that. This is what, I mean, we were discussing at lunch. It doesn't operationally in any way reduce your readiness at all. In any case, how do you prove no first use? There's no way until the bad things happen. So nothing in your posture really is handicapped by declaring this. So when Pakistan doesn't declare it, it's not because it plans to use them. It's really trying to deter you from making a conventional attack. And we don't have such a fear about Pakistan or even China. So there's nothing we gain by having, by giving up this no first use. So probably it'll go on forever. There is some pressure from China. A couple of defense ministers have said it. People say, dal mein kuch kala hai. There must be some reason. But I don't know whether there's any real serious intention. Anyway, the present government is not interested in these matters. You know, you can't get them interested in strategic issues. They have other things on mind.
So,
pleasure. Thank you. Thank you. I tend to run away with.